Greetings and welcome to another Monday morning Clive Live-ish. We won't make the mistake that we did last week. Obviously, these are pre-recorded a little bit earlier than when they go live on the Monday morning, just so we can edit them and make ourselves all look fabulous. But we made the mistake last week of announcing something and then it got changed by the Victorian government. Isn't that right, Jude?
Yes, well, here we are. I'm still in my room. I haven't left the house and it's not looking like I'm going to leave the house till the end of October now. So, we were a little bit excited a bit too soon last week. We're still in lockdown here in Victoria. Salons are still shut and we are just doing what we have to do and we will get there, but here we are.
Well, there's one thing that's consistent, that is that we'll continue to bring you these every Monday morning and give you a really good selection of the people within the Muk family. As I keep mentioning every week, the objective of this is to introduce you to as many amazing people as we have within the Muk family. And today is no exception. We have gone over to Western Australia and we are interviewing the one and only Tiffany Victor. Hey, Tiffany, how are you?
Hi, Clive. Hi, Judy. I'm really good, thanks.
Awesome stuff. It looks very sunny there.
Yes. Yeah, we've got beautiful weather.
Is it miserable where you are, Jude?
Actually, at the moment, it was cloudy, but the sun's out at the moment, which is really good.
It's been pretty horrible. It was 24 degrees yesterday in Sydney, a lovely sunny day. And it's like, I've literally gone from Sydney to Manchester today. Anyway, Tiffany, it's great to have you on the show. I'm sure you've seen the way that these things work. We've got a series of questions that we're going to ask you, but most of all, it's just about having a really informal conversation. So we really appreciate you coming on today. So what we're going to get you to do to start off with is just do a brief intro to yourself and a little bit about your background of your hairdressing career.
Thanks, Clive. So, a bit of an intro about myself and my hairdressing career. I've been hairdressing for about 13 years, give or take, on the salon floor. I started off as a tea and tidy for my auntie when she had her salon. I think I was about 12 years old when I did that. So that's obviously a bit longer than 13 years. And I have two salons over here in Western Australia. I have New Trends in Armidale and I also have Evo Head Studio in Byford. And I'm a mum of three young kids. I've got Amelia, who's nearly eight, Seth, who's five, and Zoe, who is 2.5. And I have my husband. And, that's just a bit about me, my busy life.
Wow, that's a busy life for sure, Tiffany, and we'll get into that a little bit later. But how did you actually become part of the Muk family? How did that all happen?
So I had worked with Muk Retail in my previous salons, and I actually came across Muk on your Facebook page. It posted one day about having a vegan colour range. And I was looking to set up my salons and I thought, this sounds really good. Something that is not sort of known about too much. And I felt like the vegan cruelty-free thing is the way that salons and beauty industry would be going in the future. So I decided to contact Muk and it went from there.
Yeah, wow, fantastic. And so that was at the point of actually you've been using it since you set up your salon.
Yes, so we're just about to have our second birthday for both the salons and we've been using it in the salon and the retail since then and very happy.
That's great.
Wow. I was just doing the maths as well. 13 years on the floor as a hairdresser, you've had three children and the eldest is eight and you're juggling two businesses. I applaud you right there. That's fantastic. Now, obviously, when you're not being a mum and being a hairdresser, what's the kind of work that your salon likes to focus on?
So we tend to do a lot of foiling, a lot of the lived-in blonde sort of look, but then also we like to tailor it to everyday clients, we're not more of an avant-garde salon or anything like that. We're in family areas, so lots of mums and that. More of your natural kind of colour work. We do a few vivids in that here and there, but it's more for that busy family, mum lifestyle and, younger girls and grey regrowths.
So, Tiffany, you mentioned that part of what why you looked into Muk was you saw that, you know, vegan, cruelty-free, that was something that appealed to you about Muk. And what I really like about, I was having a look at your Facebook page of your salon, and your banner on your on the top of your salon page is really, really clear about what you stand for and your statements in your salon, like your cruelty-free and your values. And how important is that to your business and, you know, to the clientele that you have?
So I'm going to focus on Evo Head Studio here, because that salon is came from nothing, and that's really where I try to focus on introducing more ecological views and a part of us. So we at Evo, we are obviously vegan. Any of the lines that we carry are vegan and cruelty-free. We're also a sustainable salon. And we've found that we attract a lot of clients by having these values, because clients these days, if they're given an option between more sort of chemical and not great for the environment or Australian products and also ones that are, they're always going to choose the more eco options and sustainable options and cruelty-free in that. So I was concerned to begin with, if I put too much of a focus on having this view, I might close out a lot of the market. But instead, I went with it. I felt in my heart that it wasn't going to be a phase. It was going to be something that, you know, as the businesses and that grow and the future grows across every industry, people are going to be becoming a bit more aware. So I went with that, with my gut feeling, back to myself, and we attract a lot of clients just on having those principles.
Yeah, that's really great. That's and it's, you make it very clear in your in that banner on the top of the Evo Facebook page, which I think is great for attracting clients.
And that's one of the things that we have as well in our business, is that obviously, again, we're sustainable. And one of the great things about Muk packaging is that it's aluminium and it can be recycled infinitively. Is that right?
Infinitely.
Infinitely. I can't say that word. But yeah, it's the only metal that can be recycled over and over and over again. And it is a big talking point in our business amongst our clients. And yeah, it's definitely a selling point. So I applaud you for that. Now, when it comes to business, Tiffany, do you work with a business coach at all? Or, I mean, you're obviously very busy. So do you do this all alone, or do you have someone help you along the way?
So I do use a business coach. I have used a business coach since May 2019. My hairdressing background was working in a franchise, and I loved the networking and the support that I had from that. And I just decided that I needed to have someone that I could throw myself off and that would keep me accountable, to be honest. And so I went to a seminar by Lisa Conway, Zing, it's her coaching. And I've been working with my coach, Adri, since then. And I can't explain how much of a difference that has made in my business, and not just in my business as a business owner, also my work-life balance. And my that's been a huge thing, my mindset. That's been a really big thing, that things like the coronavirus, that I would have probably had a different reaction to that previously. But having the coaching and the planning and, you know, being accountable and knowing where my business is at any one time has been, yeah, I can't explain how much of a difference that's made to my business.
Yeah, I don't think we'd be in the situation we're in today if it wasn't for a business coach. It definitely, I mean, I'm good at cutting hair. Kelly's good at doing the business side of things, but you need help with everything, whether it be swimming or soccer or just trying harder doesn't necessarily mean to say you're going to get better. You know, working hard, you've got to work smarter. And that's one of the beautiful things about working with a coach. And I think that's one of the smartest decisions we've made since we've been in business. So congratulations.
Thanks, yeah, Clive.
That's amazing. Lisa actually was originally, her salon, it was just down the road from where I live here in the Macedon Ranges. So, you know, Lisa, and yeah, she's doing great things. So when it comes to your staff, your team that you have in the salon, one of the greatest challenges that we have as an industry is staff and attracting new staff. And I saw that you had a really great post that was posting about, you know, what you stand for and what your expectations are and just real transparency about, you know, who you are, what you've got to offer, and what your expectations are of staff that you put out on your page. How has that worked, and how do you go about you know, getting staff and keeping staff in the salon?
So hiring staff and keeping staff, I think, is always going to be one of the biggest challenges for salon owners across the world. So COVID happened. Business was traveling lovely. COVID happened. Now, I know myself, being at home with the kids, I realised that a lot of our stresses came from rushing around and being stressed and always sort of having to be in different places and that. So I decided from that point that I needed to evaluate how much I was working in my business and to get that balance a bit better. And I wasn't the only one that had that revelation. My salon manager as well, she decided that she would like to go and work for herself, and that was her COVID revelation, and she's gone off and done that. And so then I was left to find new stylists. So I put the job ad out, which I'd worked with my coach to help put together. And I hired two staff within about 1 or 2 weeks, which is really good considering everything that was going on. And from them joining the team, and I also had one of my existing staff still with us, we just kept getting busier and that. And then I've hired another staff member again. So, you know, during this time where I know a lot of salons have struggled to find staff, I've been really fortunate. I think a lot of it that has come down to the fact that stylists are wanting a better work-life balance now. And that's one thing that three of the girls that I'd hired said in their interviews. They're wanting a salon where they can feel at home. They don't want that bitchy atmosphere. They want to be able to communicate with their peers. And even I've found that them communicating with me, you know, there's a lot of transparency. We have our one-on-one meetings where we just touch base, how we're going, how they've been over the last week, any challenges that they've had, how can I help them if they do have a challenge to overcome that. And if we're introducing new things into the salon, it's not me saying, we're going to do this now and here it is and doing it. It's, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? What do you think about the layout? What do you think about you know, promotions? What do you think about trading hours? Just what do you, you know, getting their feedback on things, because sometimes they can offer us a lot of things that we might not see. Sometimes we can get a bit, you know, blind in our businesses. So definitely the work-life balance has been huge. And, you know, that's what's, you know, brought my staff to make a great team. And I'm so fortunate and appreciative of the work that they do.
Yeah, that's so great. And I think, you know, you said that, you know, you've been lucky, or words to those effect, but I think a lot of that's in what you've done, and congratulations on what you've done, and that planning and being very focused on, you know, that what you've put out there has attracted the right people for you and your business, and just being open to what is important to them. And that is that work-life balance. And you are right. There's a lot of people who've really looked at their life in on every level, whether it's work or home, and reassess things this year. 2020 has definitely been the year for that.
You know, it's so interesting as well, because I love that approach of putting it to your staff. And we had a meeting this morning, and one of the things that we've learned from COVID is ask our clients as well, because, you know, we're so routine in what we do in hairdressing and working Saturdays. And but when you put it to your clients and go, would you prefer to come on a Saturday or a Monday night? You'd be shocked to find out they'd rather come on a Monday night when husband can look after the kids. And we all think it's Thursday, Friday, Saturday, because the way we're programmed. But the clients will tell you, you know what, I'd really prefer to come on different times. And, you know, and all those things, it's put it, you put it out there. If you, and feedback is, I guess the point I'm trying to make is feedback is so important, whether it be from your staff or from your clients. Incidentally, I don't know if you guys saw, I've got to stop saying that. When I watch these back, I say incidentally all the time. And I've got to stop laughing at my own jokes because it really annoys the crap out of me when I do it. And then, did you see this morning on Piers Morgan on the UK, I saw a hairdresser posted it, that on Good Morning TV, a salon in England posted a job advert and it said, must be happy. Anyway, it got pulled up saying that it was discriminating against people that weren't happy. And they got told to take it down. Did you see that? The world has gone absolutely bonkers. You know, you say, yeah, I only want people that are happy to apply. And apparently that wasn't PC. So, yeah, we won't. Anyway, I noticed that you have written recently, is it SJ Wire magazine? You wrote a great piece about common hair issues and how to fix them. Was that a new thing for you to do? And how did you come about doing that?
So I was recently approached by the SJY, which is a new magazine within our area, to write a monthly column about different things. So the first edition was about winter hair issues and scalp issues, which our clients have loved. And I didn't realize how much things like that, that we know and go on about, are affecting them. They're coming going, oh, I read this, or I didn't know this, or I'm showering too hot, and you know, things like that. So I think it's taught us, it's always a lesson in everything. It's taught us that we forget sometimes that those little things, you know, how to wash your hair properly, two shampoos, one conditioner, mid-lengths to ends, things that are so common for us are sometimes things that they don't know or that they can struggle with. I was just approached by the editor and the producer, I guess, of the magazine, and they were just looking for a salon in the local area to help provide help for their readers. So, yeah, I was really fortunate. Again, mindset and, you know, opportunities that come to you just by putting out a great mindset, I think, and being, you know, humble enough when you are asked to accept these opportunities.
That's so awesome. It's interesting you should say that, because prior to coming on here, I listened to Tim Hartley's interview with Anthony Whitaker, and he was talking about, he asked him, what do you think the future of hairdressing was about? And he said, I think we need to educate our clients how to shampoo their hair properly and condition their hair, and how important a cut is, and how to wear the natural texture. He said, because, you know, they've in COVID, because people just don't know how to wash their hair properly. And he said, it's such an important part of coming to the salon. And he said, and I see that being really the future of the way we do things. And you just nailed it by saying, you know, this, the little things that we take for granted, you know, clients just do not understand. So, yeah, it's exciting stuff. Hold on.
So, Tiffany, you're a mum, you're a partner, you're a salon owner, you're a hairdresser. I'm sure you're, you know, family member, friend. It's a big life. How do you personally kind of go about, you mentioned that you had worked with your coach on helping with, you know, sort of creating a bit more balance in your life. Tell us a bit about that. How do you do it all? How do you go about sort of doing the best you can in every area?
Thanks, Judy. That's such a compliment to have that recognized. So thank you. I think there's a lot of people that help me. It's obviously not just me. It takes a team of people, but I think my number one supporter is definitely my husband. Mm-hmm. He actually works, so FIFO, fly in, fly out. So he goes up to the mines for 8 days and then he's home for 6 days. So when he's away, I'm pretty routine driven. It does with three kids go upside down sometimes, and that's okay. So when he's home, he is super dad, takes over the house and just everything steps up. So that allows me to use that time to focus on the business and to focus on having me time to catch up with friends and, you know, just all those different things. So I think with the coaching, I worked really hard on taking myself off the salon floor for 4 days a week to school hours, 2 days, 1 week, 3 days the next. So when he's home, I work a sat day because I do love hairdressing. I really enjoy it still. And there's no way that I would be prepared to step off the floor. It definitely is busy at times. My kids are very adaptable kids as well. They've had to be, and they're pretty independent in that. So they get a bit of credit too. And just, you know, the support of my team, the support of my family, my friends, you know, it's all a balance. Life's such a balance and, you know, using your time to the best. And yeah, I don't know. Some days it doesn't go right and that's okay. I try not to be hard on myself for that. And then some days it goes really well. And, you know, that's awesome too.
Yeah, absolutely. And I couldn't agree more on a couple of things there. Number one is the best thing you can do to for your own success, I think, is choose the right partner and a partner who is very supportive of and your biggest champion of success. And it sounds like you've got that, which is amazing. And I fortunately also have that. He is, you know, amazing at supporting me with everything I've done. And kids, my kids are now a bit older than yours. And I've got to say that, you know, the days that it doesn't go right, you know, they're learning resilience as well. And they're learning what it looks like to just to keep on going and you pick up, and there's some really great lessons in that for them as well. So, and you can't have it all. You can only do the best you can. And it is all kind of about that community that you have. And again, it sounds like I've been stalking you, but I saw on your Facebook that great photo of the kids on their sports day that obviously someone had sent you. And that just reminded me so much of, you know, again, it's a village. Like as working mums, we need our village, you know, and sometimes we're the mum who's there on sports day taking the photos and sending them to the other mums, and then other times it's them sending them to us. And that's beautiful. And that really means a lot, and it's great. So the other thing that I just loved on your looking at your salon page was, and as a mum, only a mum would know how amazing this would be, was the frozen promotion that you did in the salon. How fantastic was that? That was such a great idea. Like, how did that go?
Thanks, Judy. The frozen day was so much fun, and I can't take the credit for that idea. That was my salon manager, Belinda's idea. She loves dress-ups and that. So she had the idea of, you know, doing this. We are in Byford. It is a family area. And so we dressed up for the day as Elsa and Anna. And I don't know who had more fun, like us or the kids. But I think that day we had 25 kids come in, and some of them were like a 40, 50 minute drive away just because they'd seen it through the power of social media. And, you know, we all know that kids' cuts aren't the biggest thing to bring in cash flow and that, but it was more about, one, to get our awareness out there and have some fun. And, you know, these kids were just, oh, it was beautiful. Like asking if we could go home with them, then being absolutely starstruck to talk to us, you know, they were just like, I love you, Elsa. I love you, Anna. Like, it was so cute. It was such a fun day. As I said, I can't take all the credit. We ran with it. But yeah, it was a really good and so fun to do something different. We ended up having to do an interview that day, I think, for our work experience girl. And here's Elsa and Anna dressed up interviewing someone about the work experience.
That is so cool. I love it. We'll have to. Yeah. I wish I was there. I could have been Sven. Could have had some antlers or something. That is so brilliant. And I love the fact that people drove for so long, you know, 50 minute drive. And so, on that note, which is your best way, do you think, of attracting new clients? Is it word of mouth or is it social media? Obviously, I'm old, so, you know, social media is not my best friend. But what's the best way that you find works really well for your business?
The best ways, because there's obviously more than one, of finding new clients for the salon, especially for Evo being only 2 years old, has definitely been social media. I didn't have an Instagram account or anything like that before I had started the business. I had been off Facebook for 12 months before that as well. But it's honestly the biggest way, and just producing photos and putting it out there, it spreads like wildfire sometimes. Sometimes I've had photos that have gone up and then I've had, you know, three or four bookings just from that. And even just inquiries and being able to be in touch. Not everyone has the time to contact you during work hours, or and some people are a bit nervous these days about, you know, asking questions and things like that. So definitely power of social media and also word of mouth. You know, being a new business and that, we get often client referrals from other people, and even getting tagged on your local community buy and sell pages, all that sort of stuff, recommendations from hair salons and that. That's also another powerful thing to bring in clients. We're on the outside of a shopping complex. We've just got a Woolies and a couple of other little stores. So we're not walk by trade sort of salon. We're a destination salon to an extent. And so we don't have the luxury of clients walking past and seeing us to come in. We're actually tucked around the corner. So social media has been huge for us.
That's awesome. I've got a boy question for you as well. Armadale, is that the place where they uncouple the road trains when they come in from the eastern states? Is that right?
No, I don't think so. I think that's more
different place.
It gets confused a little bit with Armadale and the eastern states. So it's about 40-ish minutes from the city. That Armadale is more of, it's a bit of an older area now. We was always one of the further out sort of suburbs, and Byford used to be like cow paddocks and horse things, and so that's grown so much.
Like, wow. Just expanding.
So a question that about, you know, something I'm passionate about, education. Well, we're all passionate about education, and lifelong learning is obviously a strategy for you and a passion to, you know, that's helped you with, you know, being successful and continuing to be successful. Tell us about the education that's in place for yourself and for the salon.
So the education that we do in salon, obviously this year it looks a little different with COVID happening, in that we're relying a lot digitally on education. So during COVID, we were only closed for about 3 and a bit weeks. So we had a lot of online stuff that we would watch then, and a couple of Zoom meetings. And then we obviously used to go to like Look and Learns and that, provided by Muk last year. And then we also have our amazing techs, Kelly and Lauren, that come in salon and tailor the training to what the staff need to work on, strengths and weaknesses. We also learn a lot from each other. We've had a lot of compliments in the salon from clients who we've not realised, but one of us complimenting someone's work, well, how did you do this? Or what colour did you do that? They love seeing that. They just think it's such a great salon environment when you're happy to learn from each other, and, you know, that you don't know everything, because no one knows everything. And if you think you know everything, I think it's time to leave the industry. Yeah. And these days, again, you can't go past social media, you know, just the wealth of knowledge in that. When I first started hairdressing, it was like hairdressing magazines and things like that that you'd have to learn from, whereas now you can watch all these different techniques and go into the salon and try it. And then personally, as like for personal development, I obviously work with my coach. So I meet with them every fortnight, chat to them all the time, and we just set ourselves little goals and tick them off as we go.
Yeah, it's important to get little goals, little chips. My brain was spinning then, and I just went back to the Julia and Grace interview. You know, when you're talking about on the salon floor and you bounce off each other, that just took me back to when they were talking about having the third person in the consultation. I thought that was such a clever idea. And it's one of those ideas, you know, in hairdressing, things come in, you think, I must remember that. Yeah. And then I forgot all about it. And then you've just reminded me of it. I was off with the fairies then, visualizing the consultation. But, you know, little goals, little things at a time is what's important. You know, I love a good quote, right? I'm always looking by different quotes of what we see. So, or what we hear. Every week I try and find a new quote to work by or live by, you know, to be a better person. What's the best quote that you've ever heard or been given? It could be about life or hairdressing.
The best quote, you know what?
The best advice, sorry, not quote.
Advice quote. I think I struggle with a little bit because it changes all the time. It depends on the situation that I'm in and wherever I'm at in my life and whether I am professionally or personally. So I guess you just can't go past, always being able to have a laugh about things. I'm a big joker. My husband and I are big jokers. I think some people think we're nuts, but, and then also, to be humble. I struggle a little bit with this one, if I'm honest, because I change all the time, whether it's, mindset and, balance and all that sorts of things. So I guess, yeah, all those things together. I really don't have a quote that I go off. I'm so sorry. Or advice. I don't know. I give a lot of people advice, whether they want it or not sometimes. Yeah. But, nothing that I really come back to every time. It all changes.
I'm a bit like that. I'm all over the place, If I see something and I go, oh, that's good for this week, and then I'll do see a new one. Something shiny. I read one this morning. It was quite good. It said, if you want the world to be a better place, smile. And I thought that's so simple. Like just smile and it's infectious, right? So over to you, Jude.
So you mentioned social media and, sort of being inspired. Who do you look to? What's inspiring you at the moment? What is it that you're looking for and going back into the salon and trying at the moment?
So people who inspire me, I look a lot personally to, and as a business owner, to other women that are successful and that are working mums a lot of the time and that too, because I know that balance is like such a juggle at times. So I think that I look to a lot of those people for inspiration. I can't really name anyone sort of off the top of my head because I follow lots of people, well-known people and people who are just, everyday kind of people. Yeah, I get a lot of inspiration from the people who are around me as well. I get inspired work-wise by the staff and the girls that I work with and things that I see on just generally scrolling through on social media. It doesn't need to be anyone of significance. I follow a few people from America, England, sort of everywhere. I love what I see on the Muk page as well. I use that page all the time. That is one of the best things that I love about being with Muk is having that page. And whenever I have hired new staff, I can't wait to show them this page. And they all love it because I think that's something that a lot of other brands probably lack, that support and, having that, it's almost like having that extra person when you are mixing a colour or something like that to, go onto the page and have a look at what formulas people have used before. So, yeah, I draw inspiration from everywhere around me.
Yeah, that's great. And I'm so glad that you're using it that way because that's exactly what it's there for. It's like, with everyone sharing what they're doing and their formulas it's designed for us all to be very open and share what we're doing. And if it's something that can be helpful, that's fantastic.
It is a village, isn't it? It's definitely a village to go to. It's like and you're right. You hit that on the head. Not many other companies have that where you can just showcase. Everyone can have a voice, and that's really important. What can you do today that you couldn't do a year ago?
What could I do today that I couldn't do a year ago? I've definitely got a lot better with technology looking at different ways of learning and things like that, because that's something that I think would have probably. I wouldn't have maybe not even entertained the idea. And reactions to things as well. 2020 was my goal to work on my mindset, which was it definitely gave me the challenge. I think the way that I look at things and approach things and that now has probably over the last year really changed and definitely for the better in that.
Awesome. Yeah, mindset is a big thing for 2020. Mm. One of the things that I'm learning to do is meditate, and I do it every morning. I was telling Judy this morning that I watched a documentary yesterday, which was recommendation of Kelly, and they said you wash your body every day to wash the dirt off from yesterday, but you don't wash your mind. And you get up and you put your phone and your news and you're Trump and you're this and you're that and you form an opinion and you see your stuff, but your mind gets clogged. But just to wash your mind to start your day is at the ripe old age of 51, I think is a really good thing to do. Like it's a good way to start the day. So, yeah.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Is. Hey, Tiffany, what are your two can't live without Muk products?
My two can't live without. Well, I think one of the things that really drew me to the range is the deep Muk shampoo and conditioner. That's what I loved when I worked in a salon that had it in the retail. I kept going back to, you know, with heaps of options of other brands, but that's what I kept going back to. So I think that they're my favourites.
Great.
Awesome.
They're all great, but electrical, everything. I love it all. But yeah, that's probably what, if they had sold me originally, I might not be on this journey.
That's great. The deep is, it's top of the top. It sells like, you know, everyone loves the deep range. It just leaves the hair feeling amazing. It's a great product.
It is. I highly recommend it myself. It's fantastic. quick word, these messages from our sponsor. We are the only Australian brand that does electrical, colour and retail. Anyway, I've got to stop doing that. Anyway, what is your favourite place on earth that you've ever been to?
My favourite place on earth? It's a tough one. I really loved when I went to Las Vegas and New York. Loved it. Ooh. So much fun. Think about it every day.
That was 2 weeks in a row without New York.
That's yeah. Good.
Yeah. We love both you. Amazing places.
Uh-huh. Absolutely.
I wonder what Las Vegas looks like right now. I quite often think about that with, you know, the COVID situation, because pockets of America are carrying on like nothing's happening. And, you know, and then you've got situations like California. I wonder what's going on in Vegas. It is an amazing place, isn't it, Vegas? It's one of those places that you love to, I love going and I love leaving. It's like, everyone's asleep on the plane because they get first time they've had oxygen since they've left the casino.
Yeah,
okay.
When I left first Las Vegas, let's just say that.
What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Yeah,
very much so.
Yeah, if only I could remember it. Where's next on your bucket list? Where would you most like to go?
Okay.
Anywhere right now.
Right now. Okay. So add to everything that I am doing, I'm also currently renovating a 1984 Viscount caravan. So my goal with that, it's I'm stripping it out, I'm renovating it, loving that. It's a project for me. So I really just can't wait just to go away with my family, just around WA, just take off and just live minimally and just be together. So yeah, once I finish that, I'm just going to pop around WA for now.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, it
That's
does.
Your gig as well, isn't it, Jude?
Yeah, that sounds fantastic.
You love an RV.
Yeah, that's so good. And you're renovating it yourself. That's amazing. You'll have to send me photos. That's incredible.
I will.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah. I'll send you through some pictures. I've gutted it at the moment and I've got heaps of inspiration on my Pinterest and everything like that. But, yeah, that's my little project for me. I'm on top of everything else that I do. I know everyone thinks I'm nuts, but... Hey.
You know what, though? Those kind of projects kind of, I find, when you've got a creative project like that on the go, when you're a busy person, it kind of helps you. It actually invigorates you and it actually makes everything else easier, as bizarre as that sounds. But I totally get it. I get it. It energises you.
Absolutely. That's exactly it.
Yeah.
I think we're all going to be very grateful for lots of things. Like, you know, just you saying, just going around WA, you know, just so many things are right around us. I was walking home yesterday and there's a bush that's just all of a sudden just covered in white flowers, you know, which I've never seen before. You know what I mean? It's like, I've lived in this area for 19 years, you know, and I've never known that bush flower. Little things are really important. What are you most grateful for? And you've touched on it a little bit. Well, what are you most grateful for in your life right now?
Oh, absolutely. My family, my friends. I know that's a bit of a cliche answer. But you know, without them, I wouldn't have anything. They make me rich. and humble and that too. And I'm also really grateful for the opportunities. I seem to have a lot come my way, and I'm definitely very fortunate and grateful for them. So you can't go past family and friends, can you?
That was such a good choice of words. Rich. I love it.
Yeah.
We're all about family, aren't we, Jude?
We sure are. Muk family. One big family.
Love it.
You can choose your friends. You can't choose your family. Oh, dear. Right. Now, I touched a little bit earlier on about a documentary that Kelly recommended that I watch. It's called Heal, right? And it's about the power of meditation and how you can heal your body. Is there any podcasts or playlists that are your go-to that you, if you're walking or going for a run or whatever, is there anything that is your go-to to listen to?
My go-to podcasts and playlists. So it really depends on my mood. I'm really mood driven with music. So in the salon, especially on a Saturday, I love nothing more than an upbeat house kind of tunes and that. And I like to listen to meditation music and that too. If I'm feeling a bit overwhelmed with just everything that's going on, to help me sleep better. If I'm feeling a bit angry, it might be a bit of heavy explicit R&B where the kids might learn a few words. I'm really mood driven. So, and I think music creates your mood too.
It does. It's very much different times of the day, different types of music. You know, I was listening to that Tim Hartley interview today with Anthony Whitaker, and he spoke about how Andy Warhol, when they were making the prints, they would listen to the Velvet Underground, and then I can't remember what the opera was, but it was one extreme to the other, like one was punk and the other one was opera. And when he read that, the first thing he did was he went out to the record store in Leeds and he bought both of them to listen to go one creative, one extreme to the other. And I think that's what it is, isn't it? Music, podcasts, whether you're at the gym or we're walking, it's like what I feel like walking to today. Some days I listen to things that inspire me. Some days I just want to zone out and listen to something that's, whatever. But it's different horses for courses. Jude.
So, Tiffany, I just wanted to wrap things up by saying what an absolute pleasure it's been spending some time with you and getting to know you, and just how, your insights and sharing so openly about, what it looks like to be a multi-salon owner, a mum, doing the juggle and doing it so well and being so open with everyone with what that looks like. And your honesty and your humility with that has been really beautiful to have a chat with you today and have you sort of be part of the Muk family and share that with the family. I can't thank you enough. And so thank you so much for spending some time with us today in your busy schedule when you could have been renovating the caravan.
Thanks so much, G. Thanks so much, Clive. I feel very, very fortunate to be given this opportunity. So, it means a lot to me because there's a lot of salon owners out there that are mums. And I think when I first started, that's one thing I struggled with was finding other working mums that, could do the balance. And so I hope that, other mums, are able to feel like they're not alone, because sometimes it can be a little bit lonely. Mother's guilt, I'm sure you'd know what that's like, Judi. Thank you guys so much. And thank you to the Muk family. I'm so lucky over here in WA. I have amazing, with Anne, Lauren and Kelly, amazing support too. And just so approachable and, just their relationships. That's what Muk's all about, isn't it?
Yeah, that's absolutely. That's exactly what we're about.
Well, I don't know about you, Judi, but I could go on another hour here because I find you truly inspirational, Tiffany. I really do. And you are an inspiration to every working mum out there. And I know there's lots of them in this industry. You are not only a successful business person, you're just, a beautiful human. And it's been really great chatting to you on the show. And I can't wait until we can travel and we can do this more face-to-face, because I think there's a lot more I can learn from you from chatting to you. So... until that time, thank you once again. Thank you, Jude.
Pleasure.
Okay. Thanks once again.
I'm not going anywhere. I'll be here next week too.
Yeah, no, we'll be around. Thank you so much.
Thanks, guys. It's been awesome. Thank you so much.